Hi, this year is the year of relationship evangelism or friendship evangelism. We're asking each individual to make two new friends for Jesus. How do you make a new friend? First, you have to build trust. A relationship or friendship is established on trust. How do you build trust? By performing simple acts of kindness toward this individual over a period of time. Let's begin this week by giving someone a book, a magazine, a fruit basket, or doing something that will make that individual happy. You'll see, they'll soon become your friend.
To the Longview Heights Seventh-day Adventist Church service. Our pastor, Minister Alex Horton, will be joining us later with a word from the Lord. We are so elated that you have chosen to join us today in our virtual worship experience. Take this opportunity to call or text a friend and invite them to join us. Now let's begin our worship service experience.
Thank you. Good morning, church family. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for being so good to us. There is so much going around in this world today, and there is so much panic and fear all throughout our land. But Lord, you said that you have not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of love and sound mind. And because of you, and because we know you, we don't have to worry about anything. So, Lord, this day you gave us to set aside, to cast aside all of our worries and our cares, and to focus on you. And that's what we're going to do today, because you have been a mighty good God. You've been a great God, and you have shown in our lives that you can do anything but fail. So, Lord, bless us this day as we commune together online and receive the word from our pastor today. Dear Father, bless those who will be watching online today, Lord, because we know that you have the power to touch everyone in their prospective homes or wherever they may be. Lord, we just ask that you would just remind us and show us once again how much you love us. Give us the strength and the courage to go out and tell someone about you and what you have done for us. And when we run into those, Lord, who may have some fear or some anxiety about what's going on today, Lord, help us to point them to you and show them that you are a God that comes through for his people. For you've shown in the past that you have come through for us and you'll do it again in the future. So help us not to dread the things that we hear on television, and help us not to fear the rumors that may be going around on our jobs. but help us to always remember that you are a God who comes through for his children. You did it for Moses and the children of Israel, and you'll do it for us today. Dear Father, just help us to remember where all of our help comes from. Your word says it comes from the Lord. Bless us this day in Jesus' name. Amen. God can do anything but fail.
I want to invite you to just go back with me to the story of Elijah and the widow woman in Zarephath. Elijah was living basically out in the wilderness. There was a famine going on in the area, and the brook where he was living was dried up, and he was told to go to Zarephath and meet a widow woman. When he got to Zarephath, he saw this woman out picking up sticks, and he asked her to give him some water. And she gave him some water, and then he said, "Will you make me a cake?" The woman looked at him, and she said, "I only have enough meal and enough oil to make my son and I a cake, and then we're going to eat it and die." Elijah looked at her and said, "Make me mine first." Now, this woman could have said to him, "I can't do that. I want to eat." But she did make it for him first. And because of her faithfulness, Elijah said, "The Lord has told me to tell you that your bread will be sure." In other words, your oil will never run out. Your flour will never run out until the famine is over. So as you think about giving, I know you have bills to pay, your house note, your car note, maybe your utilities, and it's going to be very challenging for you to give. But I'm challenging you to put God first. As Elijah said to that lady, your oil will never run out. Your meal will never run out until the famine is over. God will take care of you. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for allowing us the opportunity to give. Please bless our offering. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everybody. God bless you real good. I'm so glad that you're part of our worship service today at Longview Heights Seventh-day Adventist Church. We're so thankful that the God we serve is still leading and guiding. He has given us some words of encouragement. In the book of Acts, chapter 1 and verse 8, he said, "But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me in all Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and in the uttermost part of the earth." That is what we're doing today. We're going to the uttermost part of the earth, witnessing the truth in Jesus Christ. We're so thankful that God has given us some platforms, some avenues, even in stressful times, to tell others about Jesus Christ. This morning, there is a word from the Lord. And I'd like for you to turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Luke. And just before you turn, let's just bow our heads and ask the Holy Spirit to come in this worship service. Father, Lord in heaven, we're thankful for your many blessings. Speak through your word today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Our scripture is found in the book of Luke, chapter 5. And let's start with verse 17 and read through verse 20. Luke chapter 5, starting with verse 17. "Now it happened on a certain day, as he was teaching, that there were Pharisees and teachers of the law sitting by, who had come out of every town of Galilee, Judea, and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was present to heal them." Verse 18, "Then behold, men brought on a bed a man who was paralyzed, whom they sought to bring in and lay before him." Verse 19, "And when they could not find how they might bring him in, because of the crowd, they went up on the housetop and let him down with his bed through the tinneling into the midst before Jesus." Verse 20, "When he saw their faith, he said to him, 'Man, your sins are forgiven.'" Luke chapter 5 and verse 17 through 20. Capernaum was a chosen headquarters for Jesus. It was the mission central for him. It was his city. It was where people that loved him and cared for him, that's where they were. Often in Capernaum, he would come and he would preach. He preached many sermons there, and he'd heal everybody that came. He loved Capernaum. Peter and Matthew and Andrew lived in Capernaum, maybe even James and John. Many miracles were performed in Capernaum. Capernaum is mentioned 16 times in the New Testament. This was his city. This was his place where he really got off. It was his go-to city. Jesus was visiting somebody's home. We don't know who it was, but probably a Bible study, because Jesus loved interactions with people. He didn't always just worship in church. He would come to your home and worship with you. He would study the Word of God, the Old Testament scriptures, right in the home of those that wanted him to come. And while he was there, the Bible says that people came from Jerusalem and from Judea. They were the Pharisees that the text mentioned. Pharisees were separatists. They believed they were so holy that they had to separate from everybody else. They didn't want anyone to come close to them to make them unholy. And they were teachers of the law. In fact, these Pharisees hated Jesus. They didn't want to have anything to do. In fact, they wanted to confuse the congregation and make Jesus seem as if he was not telling the truth. They did not accept Jesus as the Savior, as the Son of God. And constantly, they tried to find ways to get rid of Jesus. But you can't get rid of Jesus. And they tried, though. They tried. And so with all of their might, they were listening for some way to find fault with Jesus. All of his teachings they recorded. They made notes and they were getting ready to ask questions and they were watching everything he did. They were there at the Bible study. I like what the Bible says, though. The Bible says, and the power of God was present to heal them. That's what I like about God. Even people that don't like him, even people that claim that he does not exist, even people that are atheists and people that are heathens and people that don't care about God, his power is present to heal them. Hallelujah. God doesn't just work with people that love him. He works with people that hate him. He goes around people that don't care about him. He will even work with religious people. He will even work with people that don't want to really call his name. But that's okay because he loves us so much, his power is present to heal. The patient was paralyzed. And when Jesus saw the man laying before him, Jesus said, "Thy sins be forgiven." Sins be forgiven. Strange thing to say to a man that comes from healing. Somebody that wanted to be relieved from his paralysis. And Jesus says, "Your sins be forgiven." I believe that man was okay with that. Because this man knew that Jesus was a healer. And healing is a strange thing. See, healing does not just come from the outside, but real healing starts on the inside. Jesus doesn't just deal with the symptoms of the paralysis. He deals with the origin of the paralysis. And the Bible lets us know that the wages of sin is death. So if Jesus heals your paralysis or your cancer and you still are a sinner, you're just a healthy sinner going to hell. If Jesus heals your diabetes or heals your high blood pressure and you keep on living a sinful life, then you're just a person that doesn't have diabetes or doesn't have blood pressure, but you're still not healed. Real healing is a strange thing because it's not something on the outside. Real healing is on the inside. The Pharisees listened to Jesus and they exclaimed that what he just said was blasphemy. Blasphemy, according to these Pharisees, is when you as a man claim that you can forgive sins. There are some people even today that think that just because they have a name or someone said that they have authority, that they have power to forgive sins. I want to tell you today, ladies and gentlemen, that men cannot forgive men's sins. Not women's sins either. You can't forgive anybody's sins because we all are sinners. I know I'm right about it. Sin is something that's inside of us. And these Pharisees were right when they said, "This is blasphemy." They felt that nobody could forgive sins. They didn't say it out loud. They just thought it in their hearts. But Jesus can read your mind. And he perceived what they were thinking. And because he knew what they were thinking, he began to tell them, "Why do you think that's so hard for the Son of Man to forgive sins? Why do you think I can't do that? Do you really know who I am? I am the one that was born of a virgin. I am the one that existed before eternity existed. I am the Messiah. I am the called one from God. I am able to forgive sins because not only am I man, but I'm God at the same time. Hallelujah. God was so powerful that as he spoke to these Pharisees, I could see them get so angry and mad, and they wanted to kill Jesus, but they wouldn't do it because he was Jesus. It wasn't his time yet. And so Jesus was talking to them and tell, you know what? Jesus knows what you and I are thinking. He doesn't only look at our actions, but he looks at our motives. That's why he can judge. He doesn't just look on the outward appearance, but he judges from the heart. Jesus is the only one that has the right to do that. He knew what they were thinking, although they didn't say it. There are some people going around today that they may smile at you and say they really love you, but Jesus knows what you are thinking. He knows what's going on in your head. He reads your mind. And I believe that we need some healing of our minds. There are some people that have some dangerous minds in our world today. Healing is spiritual. Healing is spiritual. The real healing comes when you deal with sin. Sin is something that has to be dealt with if you want healing. You can't just throw it away, and you don't even know what sin is without knowing the law, because sin is revealed by the law. And so when we sin, we go against God's plan. And when we go against God's plan willfully and consistently, then we are sick. We're messed up, and there are so many ways it shows itself, but in reality, sin must be dealt with spiritually. But sin must not only be dealt with spiritually. Sin, in order to have healing from sin, there takes a supernatural power. You and I can't heal sin. We may can get you to where you're okay from asthma, or we may be able to help you where you're okay from another particular disease. We may even be able to get enough medicine in you where you don't have particular medical problems, but sin, you need a supernatural drug that only God has, and God is the only one that can heal the sinner. Healing is a strange thing. It's strange. It's strange because we don't deserve it. We know that we're doing wrong. Many of us, we do something wrong on purpose. I can look at myself and I can say most of the sins I commit are premeditated sins. Confession is good for the soul, and I realize what I'm doing is wrong, and I do it anyway. And God gives healing even to people that on purpose premeditate and sin anyway. All God says is, come to me, all ye that labor and heavy laden. All God says is, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. I wish I could get a witness today. Regardless of how bad we are, we don't deserve it. But God forgives. Healing is strange. It's strange because we need it more than once. You just can't accept the healing of God and say, okay, that's all I need, because before you know it, you've fallen again. Am I right about it? Before you know it, you've gone against God's commandments. And so you need another dose of his healing. Now, you need to, and this good news is that God says that he has more grace, more than, it's more abundant. Where sin abounds, grace much more abounds. Hallelujah. The God we serve is so much God. But even though we have sinned consistently, he's willing to forgive us if we confess our sins. It's a strange thing. See, you and I wouldn't be like that. If somebody consistently did something to us, we'd cut them off. We'd take them off of our Facebook page. We would say, no, you can't be my friend anymore. We would turn people away. We would say, don't talk to me anymore. We would hide our address from them. But what God does, he goes to the people that are not worthy. He goes to the people that are consistently going against him, and he mingles with sinners. Hallelujah. He goes around people that don't even care about him. He goes around dirty and stinky and evil people, backbiting people and gossiping people and even people that go to church and are acting a fool. He still comes to them and he gives them forgiveness, not just one time, but over and over again. Healing is strange. Healing is strange because we really can't explain it. It goes beyond our explanation. It goes beyond what we can ever imagine. Because God's love is so big, we can't really describe it. It's unfathomable. It's an eternal love. And he loves us so much that he heals us even when we don't deserve healing. Four brothers were working to save this one man. He was paralyzed. They were trying to get him to Jesus. I like this story because in order to get somebody to Jesus, somebody paralyzed, you might need some help. You might need a team. You might need some prayer warriors. You may not can do it by yourself, but something about getting together and praying and working with somebody instead of just leaving him in his paralysis, they decided to bring him to Jesus. Oh, they knew that if they could get him to Jesus, he could be healed. They had so many examples of healing in Capernaum. They said, brother, if we can just get you to Jesus, if we can just get you in front of Jesus, you would be healed. And they band together and they found that if they would work together, that the work was much easier if they worked as a team. Well, the hospital was full. Just like today, it was overrun with some hospitals have no space. And when they tried to get to Jesus in the house where Jesus was, they couldn't get in because of the crowd. Do you realize that some people can't get to Jesus because of the crowd? And maybe today, because we have to stay inside, Jesus is giving you the opportunity to come to him without a crowd. Maybe Jesus is trying to get your attention. Maybe doing all the stuff that's going on in this world today, he wants you to come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses. He wants to meet with you. He wants to have a personal invitation to come into your house. He didn't have to have a preacher to do that. He can come all by himself. And he can come and talk with you and spend some time with you. So Jesus was talking to this man. This man, he was laid right before Jesus because these four men decided to have what I call ridiculous faith. They opened up the roof. They tore it open. And they lured this man right in front of Jesus. I don't know how they did it, but the Bible says that's what they did. They lured him. They had ridiculous faith. If you can't get to Jesus in ordinary ways, you may have to choose an extraordinary way. Sometimes church people will keep you from getting to Jesus. The crowd will stop you. It's not correct to come to Jesus that way. And you just have to come to him any kind of way you can. That's called ridiculous faith. Ridiculous faith is absurd. It's laughable. People think you're a fool, but you're not doing it for the people. You realize you need Jesus. And it doesn't matter what people say. It doesn't matter what people think about you. You're not really concerned about how they talk about how you dress or what you have on or how you look or where you've been. It's because you have ridiculous faith. It is something that you don't really care about what anybody else says or does. You're going to get to Jesus. And when you have that type of faith, then you get some healing, because healing is strange. Ridiculous faith is unscientific. You can't really prove it. You can't say, well, if you do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then you get ridiculous faith. No, ridiculous faith, you can't understand it. It doesn't make any kind of sense because it's ridiculous. Walls just don't fall down because people march around them. That's called ridiculous faith. The lions that should have eaten Daniel did not eat him because Daniel had ridiculous faith. Ridiculous faith does something that is unscientific, and you really can't prove it because it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. It's strange. Healing is strange because it requires the faith that only comes from God. What does your faith look like? In times like these, what does your faith look like? It's so easy to talk about faith, but to actually demonstrate it is a different story. Real faith is biblically based. In other words, you have to take the word of God and you stand on the promises of Christ, our King. When you take the word of God and his promises and say, because God said it, this is what I believe, then God works a miracle. He makes that ridiculous faith have healing powers. It's strange. See, sins are healed by faith. You can't even get healed from sin without faith. The Bible says in the book of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, by grace are you saved through faith. It is a gift of God, lest any man should boast. Faith is imperative for healing. We have a problem in this nation, a problem that's greater than the coronavirus, a problem that's greater than our political problems. The problem is sin. Sin is an insidious virus. Sin is causing the death of people all over the world. Sin is our greatest problem. But I've got some good news today. God has given me some extra PPEs, personal protection equipment. I have a whole lot in the Word of God, but I can just give you three. I just have time to give you three this morning. Now, personal protection equipment. The first one is found in Isaiah chapter 50 and verse 4. You know, if you go and try to help somebody that's got a sin problem, you got to have the right words to say. And God says, my spirit I'm going to put in you and I'm going to give you the right words to say. I'm going to give you some personal protection equipment. Isaiah chapter 50 and verse 4, the Bible says, the Lord God has given me the tongue of the learned, that I should know how to speak a word in season to him who is weary, and awaken me morning by morning. He awakens my ear to learn, to the ear as the learned. God will give you a powerful word to share with the sinner. God will give you personal protection to encourage the weary, to strengthen the person that's going through difficulties. And in Isaiah chapter 50, verse 4, lets us know that this is a personal protection equipment that God gives you. You don't have to wait for your pastor, or you can do it yourself. All you need is the word of God. Let me see if I can give you another one. In these critical times that we live in, there's fear and perplexity. There's people that have no peace, that are worried. But God has some PPEs. He has some personal protection equipment. Isaiah chapter 27 and verse 5. Isaiah 27 and verse 5. Or let him take hold of my strength, that he may make peace with me, and he shall make peace with me. God says, I will work with you so that you will be peaceful in this critical and crazy time. I'm going to give you peace so that regardless of what's going around, you have peace with God. You can relax knowing that God will take care of you, that God is still sovereign, that he's in charge of this world. You have peace, and that's a wonderful personal protection. Oh yeah, it's good to have a mask, it's good to have gloves, and it's good to have all the different things you need to protect you. But if you don't have peace with God, you're going to always feel like you may not make it. Something's going to happen. You're worried about this person or that person. But God says, I want to give you some peace. And that comes from his word. Last personal protection equipment I want to give you is found in the book of Isaiah chapter 49, verse 24 through 25. Isaiah chapter 49, starting with verse 24. You know what? God knows that all of us have been taken captive. All of us have some addictions. Oh yes, I know I'm telling the truth. All of us have some sins that are our favorites, and we try to stop doing them, but before we know it, we're doing them again. And so God has given us some personal protection equipment that if we take hold of it, it will give us power to be victorious over sin. Isaiah chapter 49, starting with verse 24. Shall the prey be taken from the mighty? Or the captives of the righteous be delivered? Thus says the Lord, even the captives of the mighty shall be taken away, and the prey of the terrible be delivered. For I will contend with him who contends with you, and I will save your children. God says, I am so powerful that you may be taken captive, but I will deliver you. Is there anybody out there that can admit that they've been taken captive? Maybe today you've been in captivity. Maybe for weeks you've been captive. Maybe your marriage is captive. Maybe your situation with drugs is captive. Maybe you just can't stop cursing, and before you know it, you're saying something that you shouldn't say. God says, I'm going to deliver you. I'm going to give you victory over your sin. Maybe you have a pornographic thought all the time, and God says, I'm going to deliver you. Maybe you're living in a situation where you know you need to get married, and yet you're just shacking up together, and God says, I'm going to deliver you if you just take hold of my peace. If you obey my word, I will deliver you. That's the good news today. It's a personal protection equipment. And not only that, I'm going to give you a bonus. I'm going to save your children. Isn't that good news? God says, not only will I deliver you, but I'll deliver your children and your grandchildren and nieces and nephews. I'll go down the line and give you a generation of blessings if you just serve God, if you love him with your whole heart. He says, I'm going to deliver you from the captive. How many people believe the word of God? Jesus is not just healing in Capernaum. He's healing right here in the Mid-South. He's healing in the Memphis area. In fact, He's healing all over the world. If we accept His healing, it makes a difference in our lives. Jesus said to the man that was experiencing paralysis, "Rise up, take up your bed, and go to your home." Jesus will not only heal you spiritually, but He can heal you physically. See, to be honest, we all have some paralysis. I know I have a whole lot of paralysis in my life. There's some things that I need to change, and I can't change them by myself. But Jesus is saying to us today, healing is strange. You can't figure it out, but I'm willing not only to forgive you of your sins, but I can physically heal you as well. Jesus wants to heal us. Jesus wants to make a difference in your life. His tender compassion, His loving touch of healing is falling upon weary, troubled hearts right today. But healing is a strange thing. It goes beyond what we can even imagine. And He loves us so much that although we have turned away from Him, He still cares about you. Maybe you need some healing. Maybe you need some power in your life. God is saying, I'm giving you some PPEs. Huh? I'm giving you from the Word of God. If you just pick up God's Word, there is more. There's an abundance amount of protection in the Word of God. Today, right now, this very moment, the power of God is present to heal. Hey, His grace has no limit. His love has no measure. His power has no boundaries known unto man. For out of God's riches in Jesus, He gives and He gives and He gives again. Maybe today you want God to do something miraculous in your life. He is a healing God, but His healing is strange. It may not come the way you think it will come. Trust God. Use some ridiculous faith and watch God give you some strange healing. Father, which art in heaven, we're thankful for Your Word again today. We realize that we need You more now than ever before. Somebody is listening to this broadcast and they need healing. Touch them even now. Fill them with Your Spirit. Let them see that You are willing to give them the faith that they need. If they would just ask, in fact, before they would ask, You're willing to help them. Oh God, heal even today. Go into the hospital rooms. Go into the rooms where people are quarantined. Heal even today. Oh God, be with our workers that are on the front line trying to help people go through this terrible virus and heal even today. And then, Lord, be with those of us, all of us, that have an inward disease, an inward virus. Heal the sin in our lives. Give us a new heart and a new mind. And then, God, help us to always give You the praise, for You're worthy of our praise. Thank You, God, for all Your blessings. In the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
About 10 or 12 years ago, my sister-in-law, Regina Claxton, hey girl, she approached me as I was entering into the choir stand one Sabbath morning to tell me that the man who had been stalking me told her to tell me that he wouldn't give up. I would have to tell him no 100 times. So me being the polite person that I am, I took my seat, I pulled out a sheet of notebook paper, I numbered it from 1 to 100. And beside each number, I wrote the word no. And I meant that. Well, 2 years ago, for our fifth wedding anniversary.
Before we end our service, I'd like to share with you our mission and vision statements. Our mission statement is reflecting Christ by connecting, helping, reaching, inspiring, serving, and teaching. Our vision statement is, at Longview Heights SDA Church, we seek to connect all souls with the Holy Spirit, help the weak, reach the lost, inspire humanity, serve our community, and teach God's Word.
Thank you, Minister Horton, for providing us with that awesome word. Now, will you please join me in a word of prayer as we close today's service? Thank you, Lord, for giving us this opportunity to worship and fellowship with you one more day. I pray you will send the Comforter to calm us and guide us through these uncertain times. Bless each and every one who experienced this worship service today. In your precious name, amen. Thank you for worshiping with us. For more information, follow us on our Facebook page at Longview Heights SDA Church. Or you may contact us at 901-774-5431. We love to hear from you. Again, thank you for worshiping with us. And until next time, have a blessed day.
Hi, this year is the year of relationship evangelism or friendship evangelism. We're asking each individual to make two new friends for Jesus. How do you make a new friend? First, you have to build trust. A relationship or friendship is established on trust. How do you build trust? By performing simple acts of kindness toward this individual over a period of time. Let's begin this week by giving someone a book, a magazine, a fruit basket, or doing something that will make that individual happy. You'll see they'll soon become your friend.